paint is touted as easy to use, but in reality, it can frustrate even the seasoned pro. Let me give you 10 quick tips to set you up for success. Spray paint likes surfaces that are not perfectly smooth. If you start off with a surface that's shiny, you're gonna have trouble and the paint is eventually gonna peel off. The best way to basically roughen up a surface but not scratch it is to use some sandpaper, but use the right type of sandpaper. The best type of sandpaper for most projects is automotive sandpaper, and this is what it looks like if you could get it at any auto parts store. What you're looking for, and a good rule of thumb, especially for a base coat and your colors, is about 600 grit. The way you know you're looking at 600 grit is it'll say something like that, like P600. That's how you know you've got the right surface. See how it's not shiny anymore? Now it's a little bit dull, but it's not scratched up. You don't have to scratch it up. You just want to take some of the shine off of it, which roughens up the surface just a tiny bit. Which brings me to my next point. Primer. Now, they keep changing the names of these things because when you used to say primer several years ago, you were always talking about the stuff that you spray onto metal before you paint metal. Nowadays, since it got confused, they started calling plastic primer, which used to be called adhesion promoter, they started calling it primer for plastic. The point is that you need some adhesion promoter or primer for plastic before you paint plastic. Another change is they started putting adhesion promoter inside of spray paint for plastic. So if, like the Fusion line, or if it says primer for plastic already in there, then your promoter or primer for plastic really is just like spray glue. And it dries super fast and you don't need to put a lot on there, just a very, very light coat and you should be ready to go. Let's talk about color. If I want both of these pieces to be red, then I need to understand the color that's underneath. If I paint this red with spray paint, and spray paint being pretty thin, this is going to be a darker red. This is going to be a lighter red. Now, a lot of times people forget that because they think if I just spray paint this red, it's going to come out the same red that's on the cap. Not necessarily the case. If you want it to come out the same color, that brilliant red, then you need to paint it white first. So both my projects turned out okay, but as you can see, the black one is more of a darker red than the white one that turned out to a really bright blood red. So if you're looking for bright colors, start with white. The key to spray paint is light coats and smooth strokes. Spray paint is thin, so you don't want to just start spraying on your project because you're going to cause drips because it's going to build up. You want to start spraying over here, go across your project, and then stop spraying. So same thing, the other direction. Start spraying, go across your project, stop spraying. Now, there's another good example of this, and it's called the barbell effect. And if I just show you right here, you get the barbells on the end because you're changing direction, because there's more paint on the ends than there is in the middle. Well, the concept here is that you want your project to be in the middle so it gets a nice, smooth coat. Light coats, smooth strokes. Paint temperature. Temperature has a huge effect on spray paint because it's under pressure inside of a can. Now, ideally what you want is everything at room temperature. What's room temperature? Normal temperature. Somewhere around 70 degrees would be ideal. But remember, it's not just the paint that it affects, it also affects your project. Now trust me, I've learned this the hard way. If you have a project sitting out in your garage and it's under freezing outside, and then you go out there with a room temperature can of spray paint, you're still gonna have problems. The reason is because of the difference in temperatures can cause issues. So ideally, you want your project to be room temperature and your paint to be room temperature. The easiest way to warm up paint is just to stick it in a bucket of water. Warm water, not super hot. If you heat this can of spray paint up too much, it's going to explode. All you need to do is get it up to around room temperature. So a warm bucket of water is going to be fine. Just sit it in there. It doesn't take more than about 10 minutes. Now, experiment time. I'm going to show you what a warm can of spray paint looks like compared to a cold can of spray paint. The flow from the warm can is going to be much better, and it's going to be much more atomized. It's going to be a finer mist and more pressure. My cold can of spray paint is going to be splattery and not very much pressure. Nice and warm room temperature spray paint. Super strong pressure, super fine mist. Exactly what you're looking for. Cold can of spray paint. Much more spattery and not very much pressure. And I'm even pushing all the way down. And look how quickly it starts to run. Oh, it's beautiful. See all those sparkles? That's exactly what you don't want inside your lungs. Moral of the story is if you're using metallic spray paints, you need to either be doing it outside or using a mask. Don't be lazy. These masks are really awesome and they're only like 20 bucks and they last a very long time. Next tip, best fabric paint ever, enamel spray paint. Now, why won't anybody tell you that? Because they'd much rather sell you fabric paint. But I'm telling you, enamel spray paint lasts forever on fabric. So remember this t-shirt? I did it like 3 or 4 videos ago. Absolutely no fading, and I've already washed it probably 6 or 7 times. So I'm telling you, the way I found this trick out was when I started in the military about 16 years ago, we had to spray paint numbers on our t-shirts. And I had that t-shirt fell apart before the number ever faded. And it lasts probably 10 or 11 years. So I'm telling you, enamel spray paint, best fabric paint. Gone into some stencil tricks in the past, but in the future we're going to get a little bit more in detail. But for now, I just want you to know that when you use stencils for spray paint, the closer and more flush that your stencil sits on your project, the sharper the lines. So when it comes to spray painting fabric is the best example. The easiest way to do this with spongy fabric is to simply take a little bit of spray adhesive. This is the lightweight kind. You don't want the 3M super strong adhesive, heavy duty. That's not what you want. You just want the spray adhesive you can get at Walmart or somewhere like that for craft projects. When you spray that on the back of your stencil, it makes it just a little bit sticky, and then it sticks straight to the fabric and gives you very sharp lines. Don't mix types of paint. Now, you can usually get away with mixing brands of paint. It usually is not a huge deal, but you don't want to mix types of paint. And the big two types are acrylic and enamel. When you start to mix those two together in different layers, things get weird and you have some problems that are easy to avoid by just not mixing them. That brings us to clear coat, the bane of every spray paint project artist's existence. Clear coat in a can, by its very nature, is a giant pain in the butt. And the reason it is because clear coats were originally designed to be clear, protective layers on top of thin paint. Well, they have to make the clear coat inside cans thin, just like all other spray paint. The problem with that is it doesn't really work very well thin. The pros on cars and motorcycles and cool stuff like that use something called 2K clear or two-part clear. And it's almost like epoxy. You mix the two parts together, shake it up, and then you spray it immediately onto your project. And it dries quick, clear, crystal clear at that, and super, super hard. Well, in a spray can, they have to pre-mix it. It's under pressure and it's super thin, so it acts weird. The biggest thing to keep you out of trouble is to actually read the directions on the can, especially when it comes to clear coats. There's this thing called coating times, and it's the time between layers of paint. Well, they're not a huge deal with colors of paint, but as soon as you get to clear coat, it's a huge deal because paint does two things when it dries. It dries and then it cures. When you're able to touch paint and it feels dry, it's dry. But it still takes weeks to cure. It depends on the type of paint, but usually about a week and a half or a week to cure. And that means that it's done releasing the chemicals. The chemical reaction itself is done, and all of those chemicals have risen to the surface and then they've evaporated. Now, the problem is if those vapors try to evaporate away underneath your clear coat, it's gonna screw it up. And that's usually what's happening every time you have a problem with your clear coat. So the trick is either wait till your paint is completely cured, or you basically want semi-wet paint to put clear coat on top of, so they kind of mix together and the gases go through both of them at the same time and it doesn't cause problems. So the biggest thing is just read the directions. Depending on the brand, it'll tell you what their tolerances are. It'll say usually clear coat within 10 minutes of the last coat, or it'll say wait 2 weeks. Well, as dumb as it might sound on the bottle, whatever the directions say for that brand, use it, because if you don't, you're going to screw it up and you're going to be sanding down that clear coat and doing it all over again in another 2 weeks. So take your time, read the directions, and your clear coats will be fine. Last but not least, if the easiest thing to do is use two-part clear, and you can use a small spray gun for that. Well, if you still don't want to go that far, but you really want to make sure your project looks amazing, they now make two-part clear in a can. It's pretty pricey, and I'll put a link to it in the description, but understand that the way it works is it actually mixes in the can. There's a little button on the bottom you press, it starts the mixing process, you mix it up, and then you have to use the can within like a day. If you don't, it'll screw up and it won't work anymore. So they do make two-part clear in a can, but just understand it's pricey, but it does work really well if your project is really worth it. Well, that's pretty much it. If you got any questions, you know where to check us out. CommandoDesigns.com. I'm Tony D.